Of course, I knew of Jean-Baptiste de La Salle, a former student of Saint-Sulpice, as I had been. But I was chaplain of Saint-Yon in Rouen 2 years before I met him. It was in 1715 when he returned from the south of France to lead the brothers once again. I was especially interested in getting to know him because I had seen a handwritten document of the beginnings of the Institute, which he had called the Memorandum of the Beginnings. Canon de La Salle, I have been reading this document of yours where it says you have left a record of the beginnings of your Institute some 14 years ago after the first school. When did you write this document and why?
My dear Canon Blaine, you're asking me to remember events that are some 21 years ago now, but I'm very clear about why I wrote this. It was 1694, and I was preparing the first group of 12 brothers to make a commitment for the rest of their lives to teach poor children. And I wasn't sure whether I would be part of this or not. I felt I'd been led to get this group started, but I was a priest and canon of Reims. I didn't see my work, my life necessarily with them. So I decided to write this. I wrote it for those who would remember these events, the older ones. But I wrote it also for the younger ones who always thought of me as a leader, as someone who actually was raised up by God to lead them. But you see, I saw that in the future they must lead themselves. It must be one of them to lead. That's why I wrote this document at this time. And that's why, finally, I also made a commitment with them for life.
Canon de La Salle, thank you. But I'm wondering why you spent so much time explaining why you acted as you did when Monsieur Adrien Niel came to Reims.
My dear Canon Blaine, I'd been ordained only less than a year. And I'd spent most of that year working with the group who had come from Rouen, three women, sent to help found a convent in Reims. My great friend Canon Roland had started this work, but had died and left me to do the work. So that most of these past 12 months had been trying to get the town council in Reims to accept there could be another convent, because if things got bad and there was a famine, the town council would have to support them. So when Adrien Niel turned up, I didn't want to get involved in schools. This would embarrass the town council of Reims even further. But you see, I was caught in some way because it was a family matter. My sister Marie had married only 4 months previously into the Maillefer family, and Niel's patron in Rouen was Madame de Maillefer. I saw at once that I'd have to keep the noise about a new school very, very quiet. So I asked Niel to come and live with me. And then, as he wanted to make a pilgrimage to the nearby shrine of Our Lady of Lies, so while Niel was away at his pilgrimage to Notre Dame de Lies, I had time to prepare my strategy.
Canon de La Salle, from what you write in the next section of this memorandum, it seems that your involvement with Adrien Niel changed your life.
My dear Canon Blaine, I'd have to say that's true. I mean, I helped Niel because it was a family matter. And then soon after I discovered that he's been talking to Madame de Croyere and there's going to be another school. Well, I'm involved with my family. Now, I've said to you previously, I had never considered doing this. And I told Roland and his friends who wanted me to be involved with schools, I wouldn't do it. Indeed, if I consider that the charity I displayed in taking care of the first school and the first masters would ever have obliged me to live with them, I would have rejected the whole project. I must confess that at that time I saw these masters as, well, below the level of my own personal servant. The very thought of having to live with them would have been impossible. And I must confess I had 2 very difficult years when they first came and lived with me. I can see now that God, who is wise and serene, who doesn't force us to do anything against our will, wished me to give myself over to the work of the schools. But he did this in an imperceptible way and through a whole series of commitments, so that I found that these commitments ultimately led to a result which I had never intended. And so that is the story of God's providence.
Canon de la Salle, I think I can feel that as you look back on the dramatic changes in your life over the last 40 years, you are still wondering on God's providence leading you to act the way you did. Am I correct in saying this?
My dear Canon Blaine, you certainly are. I'd never envisaged doing really what my life has been. But I can see now that it was a wise and gentle God who led me in ways that I'd never anticipated. And I felt it was very important, this memorandum, for the brothers to understand that it was God who led me to do these things. I didn't want them to feel that somehow this was my work and I had to be their leader. They had to have a leader of their own eventually. I was God's largely unwilling instrument in so many of the things that happened.
And then why did you include in the text of the memorandum the complete and full text on the God's providence, which I understand the brothers didn't receive very well?
Well, Canon Blaine, you touch a very sensitive nerve when you mention that, because I think you're correct. I think it is a very fine discourse. Indeed, it's part of Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6, on the Sermon on the Mount, and I've written a meditation about it as well. I believe it, and I gave it with great sincerity to these people because they were worried about their future. And, of course, they told me just how hollow my words were, because I still had my fortune, my personal fortune. I was still canon with a large salary. And I was uttering words about providence and about how they had to rely on providence, and was something I would never have to do myself. I must confess to being very deeply shamed. And it took me some time to realize that God was speaking to me through their very resistance.
Canon de la Salle, I respect your openness in expressing the feelings that you had on such a delicate topic as resigning as a canon. But why not pass the canonry on to your brother as your family expected and as the Archbishop had advised? Surely you had foreseen the negative reaction of the family when you passed the canonry on to poor Faubert. And why provide all these reasons for your final decision and not just simply give the conclusion as you did in paragraph 10?
My dear Canon Blaine, you must remember that at that stage I was 31 years of age, and for more than half my life I'd been a canon. You're a canon of Rouen, you know what that means. I'd try to be present for the daily prayer 5 times a day, except when I was exempted, to be at the Archbishop's Council when I wanted to. My whole life was going to take a new direction, and that was something I hesitated to do. The family, of course, expected, as you said, that I would resign the canonry in favour of my brother. But that seemed to me to be something. I didn't own the canonry. The family didn't own the canonry. It was to serve the church. I couldn't do that. And that's why I looked for a poor man to see, you know, whether he perhaps would make a canon take my place. And so to resign the canonry, to me, was such an important thing. I wanted the brothers to realize that this was a moment of decision in my life. It was in response to God's providence that I resigned the canon in favor of being their leader in their work with the schools.
Canon de la Salle, I certainly admire and respect your decision in this matter, but I'm still wondering why you did not use your wealth to endow the schools.
My dear Canon Blaine, you trained at Saint-Sulpice as I did, and you'll recall the importance of receiving advice when you had to make important decisions. I was wondering what I was to do with this group of people, and it was Mademoiselle Françoise Duval, one of the women whom I saw practically every day, because she was working to help the sisters of the Child Jesus in Reims to begin. And she reminded me of Père Barret, a priest in Rouen, but now in Paris, who'd had a group of men, not unlike the men I was with. Indeed, they'd call themselves brothers. So I decided to go and see Barret, and I expected that he would give me advice? Well, he gave me advice which I found at first very unpalatable. He reminded me that his group had dispersed, his group of teachers, simply because he'd never lived with them. So he said, you have to live with them if the group is going to stay. Not something I wanted to do. He then also said to me that might should not use my money to endow the schools. As he said to me very frankly, if you endow the schools, they're your schools. If you believe God's calling you to take charge of these schools, let God decide. Give your money away to the poor. I didn't find that advice very palatable, as I said. And then there came the great famine of 1683-84, and God gave me the courage to give my fortune away. And I look back on that as God speaking to me through a Pierre Barre.
Canon de La Salle, would you like to accompany me into the chapel to see the great wheel window, which I'd like to talk to you about?
Well, certainly.
Canon de La Salle, when we look at this wheel window, it calls to mind God's great plan to save all people through the obedience of Jesus, the preaching of John the Baptist, the commitment in faith of the 12 apostles, and the zeal of a converted Paul. I know that you have written meditations on all these great saints. Why?
Well, Canon Blaine, first of all, thank you for bringing me here and reminding me of these great saints. Yes, indeed, I've written meditations on all these. Yes, they were great saints, but they were also human beings like ourselves. And I wanted the brothers to understand that just as these people promoted God's love and the gospel throughout the world, they too were called to do this in the hearts of children. It was very important for them then to have great faith, to believe that in this kind of work done day after day, they were actually carrying out the same kind of work as the apostles did. But they also needed to bring to this a certain kind of zeal, because they were going to be doing this kind of work not just 5 days a week in school, but every day of the week, because even on weekends they're going to be working with young people.
Yet in the first assembly of 1686, you lacked enthusiasm for taking vows. Instead, you encouraged the brothers to observe rules, reluctant to make any suggestion that their brotherhood should be based on vows.
Yes, you're quite correct. In 1686, these first teachers chose to call themselves brothers, and they defined their brotherhood in two ways. They were to be brothers to one another, and they were going to be older brothers to the young people whom they taught, whom God would send them. Yes, they were not going to live in a cloister or like monks behind monastery walls. Their cloister was going to be the classroom, and that was where they were to spend every day in the course of a week.
Canon de La Salle, yet in spite of what you have just said about vows, only some years later you prepared 12 brothers to commit themselves for life, and they took vows on the 6th of June 1694. You yourself made three vows with them: a vow to associate yourselves for the Christian education of the poor, a vow of obedience to your obey your elected superiors, and a vow that said you would do this for the rest of your life. And you did all this despite what you had said previously. I am confused.
Yes, Canon Blaine, I understand there does appear to be some confusion. But as I may have said earlier, I was never certain about staying with this group. I felt I'd been led to found them. But it was during the preparation of those 12 in 1694, we made a long retreat, and it was on the day, the feast day of the Holy Trinity, that we decided we would make these vows. And we did them in an interesting way. Each one wrote out the thing by hand, and in it he named the 11 other people who were there. And I did that the same way, but I signed my name to that formula of vows, John Baptist de La Salle, priest. I wanted them to realize that I was their superior at the time, but in the future they must elect one of their own. And that's why I did that with them, and that's why these have remained the vows that we make in our institute.
And I presume now that you are going to seek the approval of the church and of the king for the permanent status of your brothers.
My dear Canon Blainer, I'm afraid to say that I'm not going to do that. But perhaps you've seen as we've conversed today that this is God's work. God has led me in a way that I'd never planned. My life appears to me sometimes to be completely unplanned. If God wants this work to survive, as I'd been told when I went to Paris to see Père Barré, he said, if you found these schools, they're your schools. But if you believe God wants you to found them, let God found them. That's what I've tried to do. Therefore, it's not for me to decide now that they'll be approved. God wanted this to begin. God also will see that these schools are approved. If it's his work, it will survive.
Canon de La Salle, I'd like to thank you for helping me to understand why you wrote this memorandum on the beginnings. It is indeed an inspiring account of how you felt yourself led by God's providence in establishing the Brothers' community. I hope that we can find occasions in the future to continue our conversations.
My dear Canon Blaine, it's been good for me also to retrace these steps and to realise how I've been led in a way that I'd never anticipated. I certainly will look forward to other opportunities for us to discuss this great work of God.
Thank you, Canon de La Salle.